Hi folks, it's Brother Anson here. How are you? I'm coming to you from my patio. And before I go any further, let me first apologize in advance for any unforeseen noises that you may hear in my background. But I really do love to spend time on my patio when I go through these nuggets with you. Okay? So forgive me in advance once again. Now, today we're going to be looking at Ephesians 2. Verses 8 and 9, and we're going to be breaking these two powerful verses down so we can extract more meaning from them. Amen. So it says, "For it's by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." So let's just look at a couple of definitions of terms which I will use at a later point. So we'll go through these terms right now. Mercy. So mercy is punishment which should be given, or justice which is not served and is not given to the person. So let's look at an example of that. You're speeding, the cop stops you, the cop comes to you, the cop says, "Hey, you should get a ticket," but the cop just allows you to go. That is mercy. You know that you're deserving of that ticket, you've done the crime, but for, you know, the cop decides to just give you what we call a blight. That is mercy. Let's look at an example of grace. Grace is that thing that is given for free, which the other person is incapable of obtaining for themselves. So that thing that is given for free, the other person cannot obtain it for themselves. So let's look at an example. Two people are diving, and we're talking about diving with the tanks. And one person gets stuck, and the other person, recognizing that this person is stuck and the tank is probably running out of oxygen, that person goes up to the surface, gets a tank, comes back down, and gives that person a tank. Now that is grace, because it's something that you cannot do for yourself. You're totally dependent. You're stuck under there. You're dependent on that person to get that tank, to give you air so that you can live until someone can, you know, free you and rescue you. So that's an example of grace. Now let's look at mercy and grace. Let's tie these two things together a little bit closer. So let's say that we have two friends. They've been friends from 5 years old. They've grown up, and one has become a judge, the other one has had an unfortunate life, and so they've become a criminal. And that person who has become a criminal is caught committing a crime. And lo and behold, they come before the judge, which is the friend that they knew from the time they were 5 years old. And that friend looks at them and says, "Hey, I recognize you. I recognize this person." And the friend wants to show mercy. But because the friend is a judge, the friend has to uphold the law. He has to fulfill justice. And so the friend says, "You know what? I find you, and you have to, you know, your sentence is you have to pay a fine and you have to spend some time in jail. But I choose to waive that time, since this is the first time that you're before me and there's nothing else on your criminal record. So I decide to just let that one slide, but you have to pay your fine." And that's an example of mercy, in that the person, the judge, has waived the jail sentence, but that person still has to pay a fine. Now the judge might decide, "You know what, I can see that this guy really does not have the means whereby to pay this fine, and so what I'm going to do is I'm going to write the check, and I, as his friend, I'm going to pay that fine on his behalf." That is an example. Those two, that's an example of mercy and grace working together. Mercy, remember, is when you've committed a crime and you deserve a penalty for your crime, but you have been given a chance. Your penalty, justice has not been served, and you've been given a chance. Grace is when someone bestows upon you something that you cannot obtain for yourself. Okay, now let's look at salvation. Salvation is the act of being preserved or delivered from harm, ruin, or loss, delivered from sin or the consequences of sin. See how this is getting really, really powerful. Faith, let's look at faith. Faith means a belief or a firm persuasion, an assurance, a firm conviction of faithfulness. That is faith. You have a firm belief or firm conviction. So an example of faith is this. Every single time you get in your car and you turn that key, you have faith that that car is going to drive. Anytime you sit, you go to sit on a chair, in the process that you are, in the act of actual sitting, until your butt hits that chair, you are having faith that that chair is going to hold your weight up. Amen? That is faith. But Christian faith, therefore, is often discussed in terms of believing in God's promises. So when we're talking about Christian faith, we're talking about that faith, believing in God, believing and trusting in His faithfulness, and relying on God's character, relying on His faithfulness to act on our behalf. That is faith. So when we talk about the Christian faith, that is what we're talking about. Hebrews 11 and 1 puts it this way. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. In the New Living Translation, it says, faith shows the reality of what we hope for. It is the evidence of things that we cannot see. So when we try to read Ephesians 2, verse 8 and 9 again, let's read it over and let's try to put some more meaning into this text. For it is by grace, or that thing given for free, for which you are incapable of obtaining of your own self, you have been saved, or you have been preserved or delivered from harm or loss, delivered from sin and its consequences, through faith, or the belief or persuasion, the assurance or the firm conviction in God, believing in God's promises, trusting in His faithfulness, and relying on God's character and His faithfulness to act. And it is not from yourselves. It is a gift. A gift is something that is voluntarily given without payment by you in return. Not by works. Works is the exertion of efforts by you directed to produce or accomplish something by a means of earning. That is, we work to earn or keep. Amen? So it's not by works, so that no one can boast. So hopefully Ephesians 2 verse 8 and 9 means a lot more to you. Now here's the thing. I gave you that illustration. However, it's fallen short for three reasons, and we'll go through them first very quickly. First, our plight is worse. The penalty we are facing is not just a fine. It is death. Romans 6 and 23 says this, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so we need to understand that it's not just a fine, it's not just a jail term, it is death that we are being saved by. Second, the relationship is just not a friend, the relationship is closer. This is our Father who art in heaven. This is the Father that loves us. In Matthew 6 and 9, Jesus instructs us how to pray by first addressing our Father. When he says, after this manner therefore, pray ye, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Galatians 4 and 6, Paul reminds us of our sonship. He says, because you are his sons, God sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out Abba, Father. And third, the cost is greater. It costs God far more than money. He came Himself in the form of Christ Jesus, and He paid the penalty for our sins. Romans 5 and 8 tells us, but God shows His love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. John 3, 16 and 17, Jesus explains the extent of the price He paid. when he said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent his Son into the world." For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. So I wanted to remind you of those two powerful verses, Ephesians 2, verse 8 and 9. And again, forgive me for any noise that you hear in my background. It's just the noise that we have to deal with in this life. But we have overcome, right? And we are able to press on, and we are able to share this powerful nugget. And I trust that the noise has not distracted you, but you would have extracted all that you needed to extract. So have a wonderful day. Be blessed. And I will see you again next time.